Come to Israel and you will be inundated with history, religion, and tradition. Home to one of the oldest and most important religious sites in the world, Jerusalem, ancient Israel's roots go back 1,000 years before Christ. But in modern-day Israel, you'll also find the polar opposite, a high-tech, ultra-cool, liberal Middle Eastern city that never sleeps, not even on Shabbat, Tel Aviv.
A melting pot of ancient and modern, traditional and progressive, East and West. Israel goes by two distinctly diverse names which perfectly encapsulate these dichotomies, the Holy Land and Silicon Wadi.
Because of the second name, Silicon Wadi, you'd be forgiven for thinking that Israel simply follows in California's footsteps. But the original Silicon Valley has fierce competition in the sun-kissed shores of the Mediterranean. Hot on its heels, Israel ranks second in the World Economic Forum's Innovation Index and has more than double the venture capital investment per capita than the United States. Israel has the highest density of startups in the world, but it's also a startup in and of itself. Founded in its modern incarnation just over 70 years ago, Israel has achieved 50-fold economic growth without respite from its fight for existence.
I'm Caroline Styr from the Center for the Future of Work, and I'm here in Tel Aviv talking to some of Israel's leading innovators and entrepreneurs to answer the question on everybody's lips. What makes Silicon Wadi a place of the future, and what is the secret to Israel's tech success?
לא הולכים בטל.
נועז.
חמימות.
חסרי בושה.
חוסר מורה.
ללא גבולות.
בלגן.
ישירות.
אמיץ.
In certain fields, most especially cybersecurity, Israel's success is the envy of every other major tech hub in the world. This stems directly from Israel's history of innovation and entrepreneurship, driven by necessity. Historically, the biggest necessity of all has been security. For decades already in Israel, that has involved cybersecurity. But what started as a necessity evolved into a cybersecurity ecosystem that continues to attract tech titans everywhere and has firmly positioned Silicon Wadi as a place of the future.
There are over 350 R&D centers of multinationals in Israel. Most of them have started by acquiring an Israeli company, but keeping that core team in Israel and actually increasing and growing that team into their presence in Israel. Now, that teaches us that there's something happening here that is very interesting to these multinationals. And it's not just the depth of innovation, it's not just the IP, it's the mindset.
While most futurist connoisseurs would consider jobs like cyber attack agents or cyber calamity forecasters to be jobs of the future, to those on the front line in Silicon Wadi, they're already considered traditional, but certainly not out of date by any means. The Israeli Innovation Authority already labels cyber a traditional sector. Is a high-performing cyber sector simply a question of necessity for a state surrounded by conflict? How does the IDF's innovative strength spill over into the civilian sector?
Can you tell me a bit about your military service?
Yes, so I was part of the Talpio program, which is you serve basically the Minister of Defense for roughly a decade in technology leadership positions. What we learned in Talpio is how to look broadly at a system and use those technologies to solve problems. And I think that is kind of what drives us here. So what I did at the Ministry of Defense, I headed the NAI section of the Israeli Air Force. It was fascinating work. And one of the things we did was try to speak with pilots to understand what are the mission critical needs. And then how do I develop algorithms, not just for the algorithm's sake, but to solve real world problems.
I was in the intelligence force. I can't tell you too much about what I did, confidential. But looking back at the level of responsibility that I was given as an 18-year-old, it's mind-blowing. I had life and death in my hands, literally. So the fact that you're thrown into the deep end and you're doing things with such a level of complexity and, you know, risk, it makes you grow up really quickly.
A lot of weight is put on the impact that the IDF and the military has on the innovation ecosystem in Israel.
Yeah.
Can you expand a bit on that?
Well, if you think about it, the whole population goes through the military. So you have this in a very critical age. So you get those 18-year-olds right out of school. I think the biggest education system we have is the Ministry of Defense. It's a huge, huge role in why we have the startup culture and the startup environment. So I wholeheartedly agree.
What do you think the biggest lesson or lessons Israel has to teach the world, to teach other nations how to foster such successful innovation?
Draft everybody.
The impact of military service isn't limited to those who end up working in the tech sector. The open and indiscriminate approach to military service teaches inclusivity and acceptance in the workplace. And the soft skills that every individual learns stands them in good stead for any career path they might choose.
I actually didn't serve in a programming or an intelligence community. I actually was in the artillery corps in a special forces unit, mostly running, navigating. I learned that you can, you know, stay awake all night and then function the day after, that I can carry a friend of mine on my back. I've learned a lot about what I can do as an individual. So that was an amazing experience.
Going to the military gave me my first management skills of how to deal with complicated situations and challenging situations. So working under pressure, something that it's for me was the best tool ever because I can see how I'm dealing with that every day.
The Israeli army is very supportive of the LGBT community. They're now recruiting transgenders. They're helping them to do the transition during the army. They can do it, and the army provides them with the hormones. And we have more high-rank officers. They become very open. This changes, again, the whole game.
If cyber is already considered traditional, then what do Israelis consider innovative? What does Silicon Wadi have in store for the next 10 years?
I'll say artificial intelligence applicable to a variety of industries.
I do think it's going to be AI. I think that Israel has a unique advantage, again, in AI talent plus connectivity to real needs, so ability to get data, get people to understand pain points. I think specifically in healthcare is going to be a huge vertical as well, but AI in general, I think, is going to be the big front.
I think it's SaaS, software as a service. Israel, at the end, is an island. We're surrounded by water and unfriendly neighbors. It's really hard building a drone company from Israel. Versus a software as a service company where it doesn't really matter where you're located, you know, people can use you globally.
Tel Aviv is home to an incredibly diverse mix of startups. From creative startup JoyTunes, which uses a listening AI to teach people to play the piano, to medtech, with startups like ADOC delivering world-class AI solutions in diagnostics.
So GLOAT is an AI-based career development platform, or as we kind of termed it, an internal talent marketplace that matches people through the AI with career development opportunities within enterprises, really any company, based specifically on their skills, experiences, interests, and ambitions. We believe that the future of work will have much more agile work across enterprises and startups alike. We believe that hierarchy, rigid structures like that are really, you know, barriers to innovation. And that's something that Intermobility by GLOAT really helps to break down.
What benefits do you think GLOAT have for being based here in this city?
I think the energy here is very entrepreneurial. Everyone wants to help each other, which is something that someone originally from New York, like myself, is just not used to. In Israel, there's that existential threat of we need to all band together to continue the existence of our tomorrow. And I think that is what makes people constantly innovate, and they don't think about, you know, what's to come in the same aspect. They know how to, you know, not just party like there's no tomorrow, but innovate like there's no tomorrow. Innovate to ensure tomorrow.
Part of the reason that Silicon Wadi is able to support such a diverse range of startups is the workforce's attitude towards flexibility, interdisciplinary skills, and a can-do attitude in any situation, often captured by the word chutzpah.
You've been called out as having a lot of gumption, a lot of chutzpah for founding Space IL and for your work at Flytrex. Do you agree with that perception of your character?
So a bit. You know, both me and Amit, my partner, we take out all the preconceived notice and we just focus on what can and can be done, mm-hmm. engineering-wise, business-wise. If you want to call that chutzpah, then okay, you can call that chutzpah, but it's more about what really can be done and what we think that cannot be done, but actually can be done.
Mm-hmm. It's a real kind of no limitations mentality.
That's correct. It was the same with the spacecraft. I was a young engineer, 30 years old, and I was like, sure, I can build a spacecraft. They've done that in the 60s, sent the spacecraft with a human being inside to the moon. So, so many years after that, we can do that.
Inbal Ariely's book, Chutzpah, is a must-read for anyone trying to understand what makes the talent landscape in Israel so unique. We asked her about the future of talent in Israel, and for her, it was all about interdisciplinary skills and a decreasing dependency on industry-specific workers.
I think one important shift that already exists in Israel, but we'll see more in the world, is of actually skill-based innovation versus industry-based innovation. So for example, you can start in cyber and become this expert data scientist in cyber, but then bring from that world an idea into healthcare, and everyone will be okay with that. Although you did not work in healthcare companies and you're not an expert in the healthcare industry. But what you are bringing is this skill, this expertise in a specific skill, which is can be relevant to different worlds.
One thing that's impossible to miss when you're in Tel Aviv is the sense of community, of togetherness, of strong social connection. You can feel this social connectivity throughout the city, from the bustling cafes, bars and restaurants to the lively co-working spaces. In business, this translates into a very powerful network effect.
I think actually the IDF, the Israeli Army, is the great equalizer here. People from all different segments of society, regardless of, you know, background or socioeconomic status, are brought together and they form relationships, incredibly meaningful relationships, with people who they would never, you know, encounter in their regular lives. And I think in that vein, there's some amazing programs to get more, you know, minorities and women into technology, which is incredibly exciting to see.
The fact that we're so small gives us an advantage. I'll give an example from my professional world. I'm part of a WhatsApp group of VPs for customer success that I don't particularly know. I know maybe 20. It's a group of about 200 people. And we write to each other and we support each other. And if there's a new topic, I don't know how to implement a new type of product, a new challenge, a new risk, a new tool I'd like to use, I have this huge network of people that I don't really know, but they're all Israelis, so they're all my friends. And they probably know someone who went to the army with me. So it's really easy to collaborate. So that's definitely a unique selling point that we have as Israelis.
It's difficult to talk with Israelis about what's in store for the next 10 years of their country.
I'm not a good person for this. What's the future be like in general? It's not my...
Maybe that's an Israeli thing, though. Like you said, it's more about being in the moment.
I really want to know what's going to be tomorrow. Is there a tomorrow? Are we going to be safe tomorrow? Like, this notion of 20 years from now is always like, okay, 20 years from now. Okay, why didn't you call me then?
What you can be sure of is Israel will keep innovating to solve the problems of the world. From cybersecurity to healthcare to the future of work, the tech scene in Israel has marshaled a remarkable ability to be agile, to be malleable, to pivot, qualities that every nation, organization, and individual is striving for in the digital age.
So what can people around the world learn from Israel and the Israelis?
On an individual level, I would say questioning everything, which is very challenging, but it's actually, when you think, it's built in with us. So connecting back to the root of this interest and curiosity about just anything, not taking anything as granted. Mm-hmm. On an organizational level, I'd say it's design a setting which requests, by design, people to work together. Mm-hmm. And on a national level, it's realizing that any individual can be kids, it can be teenagers, it can be young adults, professionals or immigrants, whatever. Every type of group of people in your demographics, in your social texture, can bring value and can have positive impact on the society.
There's a lot to learn from Silicon Wadi. In the sweepstakes of places of the future, Silicon Valley better watch out.
The work ahead starts today in these places of the future. Cognizant is already helping customers make their businesses, operations, and work fit for the future in the fourth industrial revolution. To learn more, please visit cognizant.com.